Amazing. Hello and welcome to Young Identities event, Resistance is My Mother Tongue, co-produced by myself and the wonderful Ali, who you might not be able to see just yet, but you'll see him in a second. We've been talking about doing an event like this for a few months now. Originally, I think we started having conversations about this in September, and really what we wanted to do is just have some fun with some poets who are bilingual and share some work, have some discussions around, I guess, being a third culture kid and having another language and feeling comfortable with the English language and feeling comfortable being from this country and from another land and what that means for us. It's more of a celebration of languages and more of a celebration of us as individual poets, and we are absolutely delighted to be bringing you some of the most incredible, insanely incredible artists within YI and friends of YI as well. And yeah, everyone's amazing, and this is going to be an absolutely amazing jam-packed hour full of just bars for days, because that's what we like to do. Why I just like to bring you bars for days, and we've got some bars for days. Okay, so we have a wonderful virtual audience in with us tonight, and they are our wonderful poet performers. Shall we go over and say hi?
Hi everybody.
Really great to be here.
This is the noisiest it's gonna get.
This is, but it's amazing to see everyone. Everyone looks amazing. And we're going to have a really fun night of poetry, aren't we, Nasima?
Absolutely. I'm so excited to present each and every one of these poets, because they're all good friends of mine and they're all incredible. Like I said, as we started, why I give you bars for days, and we tell you truths for days. And honestly, these are some of the most incredible and most prominent voices in the North.
Amazing. Hi, Nasima. Hi, yeah, it's really exciting. And like you say, we have been talking about this idea for a while. And for me, the exciting thing about this, and I think I mentioned this a few times to you at least, is when we talk about third culture, diaspora, migration, you have this feeling of not quite belonging in the home culture and not quite belonging in the host culture and being in this weird middle space where you can feel quite, it can kind of sap your confidence, not feeling like you fit in either. But for me, what I came to realize recently and through my poetry is, well, there are things that I can say that people of the host culture can't. And there are things that I can say which people of the home culture can't. And actually that's a place of confidence in itself. And to be able to speak, not try to fit into either, but try to feel confident in that middle ground, I think is my driving force, at least for what we're doing here. And I think it's something which we all share in common as well.
Yeah, we've had some really interesting discussions. So we, as a collective of poets, we've got together for one workshop and to sort of discuss and do some writing exercises based on our mother tongues and our mother languages. So we've had Bangla, we've spoken with the language of Bangla, we've spoken with the language of Shona, Gujarati, Arabic. It's just been amazing to hear words and to hear similarities and to talk about, I guess, what we feel in common as artists who don't necessarily may not perform in English, but may feel in English through our work. There's lots of things that we've discussed. I mean, I mentioned in our workshop earlier this week that I add ing to lots of words. So, for example, in Bangla, I'd say the word cooking. I would never, ever say this out loud. So I hope no one's expecting me to say the word, because somebody who's Bengali is going to see it and rip me to shreds. But anyway, it only happens in my family. So in my family, we say the word, for example, cooking. We'll say it cooking, and then I'll say it in Bangla, and then I'll add the word ing. So it's saying cook ing. If you translate it to what it means, it would mean cook ing. And it's quite ridiculous, and no one would know what the hell we're on about. But in my family, we know what we're referring to. So there's a language within your just your personal that when you're a third culture kid and when you're brought up here and you come from somewhere else or your parents come from somewhere else, you have another language that's just personal to you and your family and maybe your friends. It's been some really, really good conversation and I am looking forward to hearing everyone do some poems. So to kick off this wonderful event is my wonderful co-host and co-producer, Ali Al-Jamri. Now this poem I've heard before and I'm so excited for you all to hear it when you're ready.
This poem is called In the House of Colonialism. Titling rain smothers a blanket, baby warbles an ancient song, nursemaid dribbles English. Severed, I am born in a census year. Fukuyama claims history has ended. Tony Blair spoon feeds me Azkaban slop. Mama is unprepared for my struggle with the Dard. English, prowling university college hospital, swipes the consonants from my sleep. London is like the court of King Suleiman. I am surrounded on all sides by gin, all the associated isms of that brown face American, Disney's Aladdin. Arabic is the language of the Dard, and Dard there is resistance, is the reason I am born, like the beast man Enkidu, on the edge of civilization. But like all the orphans of English, I am taught to scorn all others. It would have worked too had my history ended, but history has come calling, and as monarchs mangle a revolution and a shotgun blows a kiss, my gin offer me no consolation. It's then, after years in the wilderness, that the priestess of the Dard finds Enkidu. By the mouth, they spill into each other consonants, a Semitic education in rebellion, until the seventh day dawns and my wisdom teeth jar in. As I read prophecies in an old ember's ashes, a tooth-sharp birthmark quivers in my skin, a compass to Eden, where we taste the apple of expression and are thrust into exile, to Dilmun, forgotten, like King Gilgamesh pinning Enkidu down a caved-in library, to Uwal, my concrete imaginary, to Bahrain, a desertified sea. I arrive home to Selmania Hospital, where the halls remember the blood. A ventilator smothers Enkidu's lips. I place a hand to his wrist and massage his ailing pulse. On a butchered tongue, I test my mother's song. Ya nuh idha dandhir al-bar, qabl al-zalazil wal-amtar, qabl al-sama yantaris ghaym, wad-dur dawra shamali. The future's pre-written in this old verse, a story burning as an ember. On a butchered tongue, I test my mother's song. Hey, captain, take one last look at our shore before the clouds gather and the rains pour, before the thunder rolls, catch the wind. Before it turns against us, catch the wind that takes us north. Though blanketing sands hide kicked embers, they glow for the mapless. Their pulsing heat, the Dard. Thank you.
Why, Ali? I feel attacked by every single line. You know, I didn't lie to anyone when I said that why I bring the fire, because you most certainly set this Zoom screen and started it off with a scorching poem. Honestly, that was such an incredible piece and I need to read it again. I'm lucky enough to have heard it already before and also to have just skimmed it. But honestly, in performance, that was insane. It was insane. And what a poem. about resistance, to kick off an event about resistance being your mother tongue. So thank you. Thank you for just making me want to just jump up and down.
No, thank you. That's such great praise coming from you as well.
And oh, stop it.
But, you know, I think I wrote this around the same time we started having our conversations, and I didn't realize until like a week before International Mother Language Day that like I had this poem where I'd written Arabic is the language of the blood and blood that is resistance. And someone might catch me on blood actually means like verses or to like to fight, to combat, but it's synonymous with. And that, I think I came up with that line at the same time that we first started talking about these ideas like 6 months ago, and I never made the connection. So like when I reread this, I thought, well, okay, this is the one that I have to bring. And yeah, it was...
I mean, in that case, I'm just going to fully take responsibility for this poem and claim it as mine, if you're okay with that. Because honestly, it was so well written, and there were so many lines in there that references, like, for example, where you started, one of the first lines was the Tony Blair line about the Azkaban slop, and you've done so many timely reminders of us growing up. The references of growing up in this country and having the Harry Potter, the Tony Blair, like there's so many things there that is so relatable. But it's like you've given me an alternative reality that didn't happen, and just absolutely messed with my head with those lines. So there, yeah, that line was insane.
And it started with conversations. It came out of conversation with Jova, who was talking to them about it. And we had this really interesting conversation where I think we both realized through that conversation that we've all grown up with the same cultural references, those of us born in the 90s and afterwards, like this kind of cultural hegemony of things like Disney, Harry Potter. And no matter where you go in the world, you're going to find Mickey Mouse and you're going to find Harry Potter. And actually, isn't that kind of sad? Like, what about all of our own stories, which are so much richer than, what is an English story about an English kid or a British kid and a British story, which is fine in itself, but it doesn't have to represent all stories. Same with Disney. Why should they be the childhood film? And what about things like, I didn't find out until much later in life about the Epic of Gilgamesh, for example, and Enkidu's a character from that, which I bring in. And that should have been part of my cultural upbringing much more than something like Aladdin, which doesn't really have anything to do with me.
And what's mad is that when we think of third culture, when we think of even like anyone from the Middle Eastern continent, and I know you have an issue with being referred to as Middle Eastern, that's another conversation for another day and another Zoom show. But anyway, what's mad about what you just said is that people and we as a culture, like as a British culture, when we think of Middle East, like we then think of Aladdin, and we sort of refer to anyone from the Middle East with Aladdin. And it's just, it's mad because our cultures are so rich and they've been almost dumbed down by Western writing and Western sort of ideals and stereotypes.
And it's really depressing, because on that Aladdin note, you know, if you watch it, it's a very American film. It's got a very American story about this boy who marries the princess, and there's nothing actually Arab about it or Muslim about it or even Indian about it, because I think, like, where is Agrabah even set? It's like this mishmash, vaguely Eastern place. But everything about it is actually very American. Like the Genie's song is all American cultural references.
Yeah.
You know, and you feel included kind of watching it as a kid, that there's this brown hero. But then I was watching it again and I felt Well, you know, the original cut of Aladdin had this line of where they cut off your nose if they don't like your face. That was in the original like broadcast of it, and then they edited that line and they changed it to something less like obviously racist. And so it's not actually inclusive at all, but it makes you kind of feel it for a little while, and then as you peel it back. So I wanted to talk about Britain, but I also wanted to talk about Bahrain, and I wanted to try and weave in some Arabic as well. And it was, yeah, it was fun. It kind of all came together with this project. I'm glad you...
Well, like I said, I'm absolutely taking credit for that poem. So thank you. Thank you so much.
So we have got more poetry for you, and the next person that we are, that I am absolutely delighted to bring on the stage, the virtual stage, is the wonderful PA Bites, who was actually one of the Word's First finalists. Woo-hoo! Yeah, I won't do that again. PA Bites, take it away.
This poem is called Soul Speak. Bullets and bombs line my tongue. Burned autumns and civil wars, Iyami. Iya hums to drown out guns. Where we're from, there is only heavy rain or scorching sun. I befriended the floor as missiles plunged. We lost a few of our cousins to village floods. The doves scream for God till moon silence. I am five and the day breaks in half, giving birth to instants, infant stars. From time to time, we can't outrun remorse. Rain remains like war remembers. Blood and fear boiling water. Freedom slips through our fingers. Rats mingle and vultures linger. Outside guts spill, ditches fill. We pray before dinner, a sanity ritual. Niger River, Omo, we all go back to Oshun. I lost four dreams before I birthed you. Every misery was worth that miracle. I see Jamaica in your smirk, a happy accident. Ife, I am heartbroken for the home you'll never learn. You are my island, and one day you will understand innocence is a dream made from the steam in heaven. Don't think about it for too long or you'll wish for Armageddon. Soon, you will see what men have done for oil makes history. Sharks mark their territory, blood and teeth are all that's left of our home country. In the void, my choice trades voice for coerced syllables in my mouth. A whisper is all I can pronounce, our names in my suitcase. When we traveled on a plane, left our country misplaced for the sake of assimilation. My heart is hungry for soul speak. Half dead, one bleeds, a punctured black lung cuts conversation. I try to speak, but meaning is impatient, gone. How does anyone translate a dying dawn? Oh, my little mum, Iyami. Yes, that's the poem.
Oh, yeah, I don't think I've actually heard you perform live, and that was beautiful.
Thank you.
Intensely beautiful. It was intensely beautiful. There, I feel like almost as if you were speaking to your future child, perhaps.
Is that what you're saying? The perspective is my mum calls me Iyami, which means my little mum. And it's kind of like a play on that, like my mum talking to me, but one day I will talk to my daughter the same way when they ask us, like, why we're not in Nigeria. My mum grew up in the civil war, so that is why I wrote that poem.
Wow. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. I definitely got the sense of like that growth of the place and what's happened, and also you having that conversation with your child. But it's interesting of what you've just said, what it means. It's really beautiful. There were some really stunning lines. My favorite has to be, I see Jamaica in your smirk, a happy accident. Talk to me about that line.
Well, my mom actually didn't know she was pregnant when she moved to Jamaica. She's a nurse. So she moved from Nigeria to Jamaica for a better life. And when she went to Jamaica, she was only there for a few months when she clocked she was pregnant. and then she had me. So I was actually an accident, but a happy accident. So.
Oh, wow. And I get that then. I see Jamaica in your smirk, because obviously, were you born in Jamaica then, or were you born?
Yeah, I was born in Jamaica. I wanted to maybe like include some patois, but I was like, let me focus on the Nigerian roots and pay homage to Jamaica instead.
So. Oh man, it was beautiful, because there's definitely like, I can see the mix of both there, and just, I don't know, there was a sense of like, a lot of references to nature, a lot of references to growth, a lot of references to a journey. And I guess like there's so many things there. There's motherhood, there's the migration element, there's coming from two different, you know, the two different places, the reference to Nigeria and to Jamaica. And yeah, it's like a generational passing. And
yeah.
I feel like a lot of us third culture kids, we don't, I mean, both of my parents have now passed away, sadly. And I feel like one of the things I probably most regret is not speaking about that, not speaking about growing up there, what it was like for my parents to grow up in Bangladesh and then compare that to growing up here. And again, like my dad fled the War of Independence in Bangladesh. And yeah, there's just lots of similarities. There's so much that it sparks off for me, and I'm from a completely different culture. So yeah, thank you for that. It was really beautiful. It was really, really beautiful.
Thank you. Thank you, Nasima. That means a lot coming from you. Thank you.
Oh, stop it. You're making me blush. You're making me blush. Okay, so that was an amazing poem from Ari, and I am, do you know what? She actually likes to be known as PA Bites. So I'm going to take that back and say it was PA Bites, but I'm going to probably just continue calling her Ari, but you're not allowed to. You have to go and search her work on YouTube and search her work and buy her work, and she goes by the name of PA Bites. Next up, we have one of my personal favourite humans, not only one of my personal favourite poets. It's the most incredible, the most colourful, the most insanely gorgeous Esther Koch.
Hello. So my poem is as yet untitled, and it is about my Irish heritage. So who said shared graves are for the poor? Who said the crack and the keol ever stop? There must be a grand flower going on in heaven. Spectres that leave tails of light like torches in the night. Demi-bodies wearing flax linen in dynastic cornflower blue. Stars catching in satin, lace and tulle. There's no utility scheme in Tir na n'Og. Weaving their colour in the dark as they dance the siege of Ennis. Sheila, with hair like Bav Kaha, a raven laugh, but not as bold, a gentle Leon Boynion, casts a yarn about the Doulahan's lantern that followed her home from the Saturday night Cayley, and her lucky Tara brooch that she left behind, and her brothers, although no longer working class men, with true Catholic benevolence, carry inebriated archangels on their backs and put them to bed. Thank you.
Oh my God, Esther, you also are one of the most incredible poets that I've ever heard who can detail something so intricately, like whether it's a colour, whether it's an expression, whether it's like whatever it is, your detail, your attention to detail when you write, I don't think I've never heard a poet detail anything as much as you do, and just have me in a place and a space and feeling something like you do. That was insane. Inebriated angel, cornflower blue. I've never heard the term cornflower blue. Is that common?
Well, that's quite meaningful. My Irish name is Gorman, and Gorman has many names, and it comes from O'Gorman, and it means son of Gorman. But then also, Gorman has meanings in the Irish language of blue bottle and cornflower blue, as in the cornflower, the flower. They are a lovely shade of blue. So it was important to me that they would be wearing something emblematic. Imagining my family in heaven or in Tin, I know, which is the afterlife.
Oh, wow. It was majestic. Honestly, it was really majestic and enamouring. And that's not just the way that you perform, but just everything about that piece. And I think you took me up to heaven. it was honestly really, really beautiful. And even the line, like, there were quite a few references to Irish things, I believe. So there was the dancing bit. The bit about the dancing, can you repeat that line, please?
Yes, of course. So that is...
The dancing Kaylee or something? Or...
Yes. So, yes. I'm trying to find it. It's a tiny poem and I can't find it. Yes, Dance the Siege of Venice. So the Siege of Venice is a famous Kaylee. I know there's a Kaylee on the call. Kaylee is a dance. Very in ancient Ireland, a Kaylee would involve, like, it was a big event of poetry telling, of storytelling, of singing, of dancing. But really, in contemporary Ireland, a Kaylee is specifically an event for dancing. The Siege of Venice is a famous dance.
I did some work a few years ago in relation to some stuff that was found in something to do with Victorian England, and it was part of Cheetham's Library. And the what I was writing about was some diary entries, and it was of this, I think she was a Scottish girl in her sort of teenage years, and I was really excited when I heard that word because I used that in that poem. So I just want to say I've got a poem with the word Kaylee in as well, not just you, Esther.
It's a lovely word.
To end that. it was a really beautiful word, and it was a really I can't describe it as anything other than majestic and just angelic, and that is very Esther. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for your work. Okay, amazing. So from one Kaylee, that is a dance form, to absolutely another incredible Kaylee. Again, one of my personal favourite poets who I've not heard poet in a long time. So I'm probably, I don't want to be biased or anything and say I'm more excited about Kaylee's work than anyone else here. But I am definitely super excited to hear Kaylee's poem. So take it away when you're ready.
The concept of knowing someone like me. Only when you're drunk, you talk about your grandmother. Her northern accent and engine's hum, the soft lila of her saris, doing DIY with your grandfather in bootcut jeans. You talk about the funeral, how you wore black by mistake, old enough to know better, a sigh of a suit. You shared a particularly Mancunian English, swearing over fish and chips, faces painted for United Games. Your jumpers smell of overripe keela and fake strawberries, and I wear them when I dress as you. Amtha, when we kiss, it's like practicing on my arm. We burn chai together and pretend to like green tea, throwing it in the garden and watching it freeze. We tick other on most forms, visit Google Translate more than Twitter. When we marry, our children will occupy the same empty space, the no man's land of multitudes. Sarafajan from rotten oak. No, we are two dead fish in a dried pond, like skimmed stones, finsa fragile as pressed leaves, buried until the pond fills.
Oh, wow, Kaylee, that was so beautiful. Was there reference of a funeral in there? Because there was one line where you said where you wore black by mistake because of custom and tradition. Am I right?
Yeah. So at Hindu funerals, you wear white. And, you know, we've all done it. And just, you know, wore black to the funeral. It's a little bit offensive, but people don't mind. It's okay.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I picked up on that line straight away. It was really, honestly, it was such a pleasure, first of all, to hear your work again after such a long time. And I absolutely appreciate you coming on board and being part of this project, because I think for me, as one of your peer artists, I don't really hear you, speaking Gujarati in your poetry, but also I don't hear the Gujarati side of you much.
Mm.
So it was a real joy to witness that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's interesting.
How did it feel?
In poetry, I found I don't really explore that. I think I was more sort of like worried about the form itself, but I've been writing short stories recently and I found it a lot more rewarding to like look into my heritage and talk about my upbringing and my childhood. So I just thought I'd bring a little bit of that here.
It was honestly really beautiful. You mentioned a phrase, amfa, am I right?
Yeah.
Amfa. What does that mean?
It means just like that. It's like a kind of comedic phrase, but I kind of wanted to add a bit of like seriousness to the phrase.
I love that that the phrase means just like that, but it's, I think I mentioned this in the workshop as well, that it's the same word again, it's the same word twice and it means just like that. And sometimes we spoke about it in our workshop, we spoke about the fact that sometimes we can't translate in English what the word in our mother tongue is. And that's just a really good example where, you know, there's so many other languages that are insanely rich. And there's never really an equivalent of what it might mean in English. And that was just a really beautiful demonstration of that.
Oh, thanks so much.
Thank you so much. That was really lovely. Thank you, Kaylee.
No worries.
We have for our next amazing, incredible, magnificent poet is the ever gorgeous Ella Otomewo.
Hi, Nasima. Hi. Thanks so much for having me. I'm quite excited about this.
I'm super excited to chat to you about your poem. Take it away.
This is a sonnet called Emetisioro, which is a name meaning children born in the diaspora. To belong to a language that you cannot speak is like watching carnival from a high window, all dressed up, leaning out and calling digwo at people in the distance who dance cheek to cheek, while their broken English get critique as if language falls apart at a foreign flow, like the center cannot hold itself and grow with new voices who offer something unique. I'm learning how to use more than words to connect, how to taste resistance on my tongue and speak it to the scattered generation and the languages we've neglected. But for now, there is no way for this British-born poet to simplify the subtleties of Nigerian tribal dialects and my linguistic identity to this single Spanish sonnet.
Oh my God, Ella, that opening line was insane. I keep using the word insane, and it makes me feel like my actual reaction isn't the same as what I'm feeling. What I'm feeling is just excitement at hearing your work after such a long time and sharing the space with you. But the opening line, to belong to a language you cannot speak.
Yeah, it's like watching a carnival from a high window.
Watching carnival from a high window. Yes, that's it. Boy, that is, you mentioned later on in the poem about you are speaking without words, but more with a connection. Am I right? I know I'm not quoting it correctly.
Yeah. No, that's kind of the feeling that I wanted to get across, like feeling very connected to this language and this dialect, but like the kind of shame that comes with actually not knowing how to speak it. like, yes, sitting from a high window and looking down and watching all these people with this culture and this color and this connection, and you're kind of there and you're noticing it, but not quite. And like, yeah, it's quite a strange feeling because there's definitely a connection that I have to the
Absolutely. I think what's really beautiful about this poem, and obviously me and you are friends outside of this space, so I know a little bit about your culture and we've spoken about it previously, but what's beautiful is what you've just beautifully and eloquently said then about wanting to, you know, attach that feeling of you know, I suppose, sort of portray this feeling of not being able to speak it, but being, but feeling connected. You've done that really beautifully, actually. And it's not just the way that you wrote it. It's just there's something about when you're from a culture, even though you don't belong in it, it belongs in you. And I think what your opening line did for me, you know, to belong in a language you cannot speak, I think instantly I feel like by saying that you belong. Does that make sense?
Yeah. I mean, that's really what I wanted to put across, that like odd sense of belonging and not belonging to like either culture, talking about kind of like some of my family members with like not having like English accents and how they're perceived as well, being like multilingual. And then for me, not really feeling like I fully belong to like either culture and like how that feels.
There's something, you know, when there's something about culture that soaks people up, regardless of what culture you're from. And I think with language, again, that's something that does that really beautifully. When you're, you know, when you speak another language or your parents speak another language than English, that foreign that you think it is, you belong in that. And I feel like a lot of whether we speak our home languages or not, like I said earlier in this recording that you'll find when you watch it, like I said earlier, I add words because I find that uncomfortableness to say things out loud, because I feel like when I say it, you don't understand what people won't understand what it means. But really, it's a new culture, like you're part of a new culture, you're part of that third culture. And I think, you know, you have a place within that as well. And it felt reassuring for me. That poem was just really reassuring.
Good. That's what I want. Yeah, because there's part of me that's like, oh, am I going to like pronounce certain words wrong? Or like, but then I'm just going to keep learning and like keep pronouncing words wrong and learning how to do that and just speaking it until I get it right. And like not feeling like I'm not able to even take part in that, because for me it's like third generation now.
Thank you so much, Ella, for sharing your work with us, and thank you for giving us the safety and the reassurance that you gave us with that piece.
Thanks, Nasima.
Next up is one of the most eloquent MCs that I've ever come across, and she is also an incredible poet. She goes by the name of Meduulla. Take it away.
Hi, Nasima. Thanks for that. I'm really excited to be here and to share my poem with you guys. So this is Oceans and Seas. There are oceans and seas that stand between you and me. And the story of our love is an old forgotten odyssey. And I know it's odd to see me be held by him. Be encompassed by a new set of arms, I feel like I'm forgetting the shade of those ruddy red palms and that deep drumming voice, religiously reciting foreign psalms. Your heart radiated a heat that hugged and honed my youthful body, and I never quite understood why your voice rushed when reading or why psalms sounded sorrowful, but it was because you knew I wouldn't last long in your arms. Being with you was like loving someone who only kissed me in public. You wore your name on my passport for the world to see, but behind closed colonial doors, we were strangers. That was the danger of long distance relationships. We had latitudes of land in between us. And the lies of our love had been left to marinate for too long, you see. I had heard of you. but only through televisions that told tall tales of your tribulations. I was taught that I have to leave you if I had any chance of an education, that you were no good for me and I should feel nothing but gratification. It's been 18 years since I left you. 18 years that I've been calling for your rescue, so it's 18 years that I've had to find a new place of refuge. But now he who holds me hates me, sells me dwindled dreams of democracy. I see that he's looking at me through his colorblind prism, which is why he doesn't understand when I speak to him of isms, because my native tongue is a self-conflicting prison. He who holds me prays for our continued separation. He laughs at my inability to say no more than would he say as a form of feeble communication. It's like I'm watching myself, losing myself, but I'm struggling to change the station. The murmurs about my motherland have turned into echoes in my eardrum. I have lost home in this not so united kingdom, and I guess you could call it Stockholm syndrome, because I was starting to fall for my abductor. The reason and the remedy for my Rhodesian rupture, and I knew this, but I still called him home. You, my home, and him, my harbor, have a complex history, so I have to choose. I have to choose between the love I have now and the love I once knew, but if home is where the heart is, my heart resides with you. We encountered each other again, and only then did I understand why the fruits of your labor tasted so bitter. We were by the Zambezi River and I told you about the way that my lip quivers each time I try and utter a word in my mother tongue. But I'd rather stutter and stammer your sentences than speak his English with ease. Thank you.
Oh, Meduulla, that was so beautiful. Such beautiful alliteration, latitudes of land, told tales of your tribulations. I'm like taking notes of everyone's poems. So if you see all of these lines in new poetry, I didn't steal them, but I did steal them. Honestly, such beautiful alliteration, and I guess the personification of your home country and Britain. Is that what I was getting?
Yeah, I was just trying to capture like how you can love both of them in different ways and just that complex relationship that you have feeling in between the two countries.
Mm. I love the reference of colonial Britain being the abductor, really fitting way to describe Britain. It was really eloquent and really, really beautiful and really, it came from here, it came from feeling, and it came from what you, yeah, it was really good. Thank you, Lulu.
Thank you.
Amazing, 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 amazing. Wow, we've had some incredible poets and we've got more incredible poets to come. Next up is the wonderful Amina Atik, my favourite Scouse queen. Another Words First finalist. Let's go.
Yeah, thank you. So this poem is called Belong, which was actually produced part of the BBC Words First workshops. So it's a nice little reminisce of how we began talking about identity and language. We swerved between checkpoints, and armed young men watched from a distance. An elderly man squatting in a dark corner stared, and a group of veiled women on the balcony giggled, and I stuck my national flag out of the car window. And the colour of my skin brushed against the plane window. And I was there. I was there in a strange land, and I was there greeted. Soon we became friends, best friends. Too soon we betrayed our roots, my olive back combed hair. I hated the smell. Falling down my back, too thick to carry, too different. I chopped it all off. And I was there in glass windows and brick walls, begging on the streets for penny for a guy. Watching the firework display light up your new city and eat a halal Christmas dinner, sprinkle grandma's spices, a taste we've been trying to recreate even if we tried. Soon my Scouse accent lingered on my tongue and I wanted to feel wanted like that. And I made sure that I did, but I slept with my mother's voice in my ear. Let and say Bladish. Let and say Bladish, but in my broken Arabic I said, Heather Hua Biladi. هذا هو بلادي, this is the home I need. And then a little ginger boy down the road, hey, where do you come from? And I picking at my skin scarred with mosquito bites to remind me what is marked shall never be forgotten. And in my perfect broken English scouse, I come from here. That's it.
Amina, Atik, that was beautiful. And I don't know why I just, I'm speaking to you with your full name. I'm sorry, Amina, that was beautiful. My favourite part of that poem was what probably so many of us are familiar with, the term, where do you come from? We get asked that a lot when you're British, but not British, when your parents come somewhere else. And I think I really, really relate to that. That where do you come from? And my favourite part was not just that. My favourite part was you saying, actually, I'm from here, and just owning your belonging. Yeah. I think what that poem did was just owning your identity.
Oh, no, thank you. I mean, this is a work in progress. I think when you're writing from a diaspora point of view, it's kind of like we're using our writing, our creative process as a way to also find answers. So ending it, I come from here, is probably something that I'm still asking myself, what is here? And it's the first poem I probably used my Arabic language, which is the broken Arabic. So I'm just so glad to be able to feel that I have a place to do that, that I can speak in broken Arabic poetry. I mean, I would love to see an anthology in the UK where we can get all of our broken languages in a poetry collection and actually owning that, and that we don't have to actually have that perfection, because even in that brokenness, there's something in that. And that shows that journey of the diaspora and what that looks like.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like we shouldn't call it a broken language. We should call it another language, a variation of a language. And honestly, like, I know bits of Arabic and it didn't seem broken to me. What that did for me anyway was just made me feel like I belong. And I think what, especially that last line, and also what I wanted to also reference to, the fact that you used I a lot. It was very orientated from your perspective and from your feeling. And again, that just, it for me as somebody who heard that, I just felt like it was really, it helped me feel rightfully here.
Oh, thank you. Well, I'm glad that could be a shared feeling. That's what poetry should do. But like I said, Nasima, this Absolutely. Is definitely a work in progress. Sometimes I do think, like, why am I even writing about poetry of identity? I want to write about my cup of tea or my travels to, I don't know, to Scotland, or, you know, going for that, you know, a walk to Sefton Park, you know. I just want to write about normal stuff. But then I feel like, as a writer, sometimes I feel like I have a responsibility, and maybe using that voice and that platform in a way that can answer these questions that a lot of our young people still are asking. Especially in the social and political climax, which can be quite confusing.
I think you said it wonderfully, but at the end of the day, you can only speak on behalf of yourself. And as poets, yeah, we write whatever comes to our pen, but you're only speaking on behalf of yourself. So try not to take all of the responsibility, Amina, but wonderful poem. Thank you.
I know, thank you.
Our next incredible poet is Jova. They are words for days, not only bars for days. Let's go.
Thanks, Nasima. So this is a poem that I wrote that's called Lengua que lamentan, no more questions. Mañana te dejaré entre multitudes de celulares viejos, recuerdos de los cuales no me logro deshacer y sueños entorpecidos de otra época. El rumbo insensato de la molestia me provoca acidez y es aquella bestia que me ha comido la voz. Inhalaciones ásperas suben con la marea y amenazan con ahogo prematuro. Mientras me observan las paredes de yeso, me tras frecuencias bien brutas, lo único que quiero es a puta y desaparecer de una puta vez. Instead, we roam through Play-Doh domes and jungle gyms, expected to stay still until recess and repay our ancestors by spitting shame. I wish my name were James, te escuchaba una vez. the delicate thoughts of a child of eight spilling over like marmalade onto Wonder Bread they didn't want in the first place. You know, 20 years before avocado toast, I had palta shoved down my throat, spat up and choked like a xenophobe, unable to stand the texture of home. Now I drink two types of tinto, one in the morning y uno en la noche. Y cuánto reproche me tuve que tragar en este hogar de mierda, donde las mentiras se reiteran por costumbre. Alguna vez me preguntaron si me creía choro y francamente les dije que sí. Sin pruebas ni evidencia, pero sí igual. Otras preguntas me dejaron más mude y aún revuelcan en los sesos jugando a la ruleta rusa. La guayaba podría, acusadora como nunca, glares at me from the abandoned market floor. When I fly, I hide my passport like a hate crime. And somehow I'm always chosen for a seemingly random baggage check. One time I'd had enough, fought with a homophobic cop, spat at the flag, and was threatened with deportation. El deporte, al final, es amenazar. Y el premio, lavando patas. I wonder if Jesus swallowed bile while washing Roman feet. Time and time again, I've been told to be grateful. Aquí no hay FARC. Aquí no hay dictadura. Sí, pero aquí está la CIA. And the FBI, which rewarded Fred Hampton with bullet holes. Happy belated birthday, by the way. Recuerdo mi viejo diciéndome apenado, ¿a dónde va, niño? Pregunta perpetua a la cual no tengo respuesta definida. No sé, pero voy. 7,6 en la voz. Y resisto el derrumbe. Por lo menos esta vez. I remember Henry Kissinger giving Hillary his blessing, smiling with bloody gums, wax dripping from his chin, acting as if Pinochet were a bad hookup from his college years. Asesino por asesino en su perfil de Grindr. Some white girl asked me, why do you hate women? Recuerdo a mi madre pidiéndome recogerme el pelo, mordiéndose la lengua para no decirme marica. Every time she asked, I felt a hair come loose. How long till I have none left? I remember George W. and the blood on his hands, now painting dogs in his spare time. A sweet old man who's left his eyes out too long. Y en vez de derretirse, me quema la lengua. Alguien me pregunta, ¿por qué no lo perdonas? I bite my tongue till it bleeds. I carry ACAB in my DNA, and I've said Paco Culiao more times than I can count. And when I refuse to kiss Biden's feet, someone asks, don't you care about kids in cages? As if my tongue isn't still sore. And my arepas were store-bought, as if he didn't open them in the first place. I'm really tired of all these fucking questions.
Jova. I don't want to ask you any questions because I'm scared. I felt like the last line was a send for me because what I'm about to do next is about to ask you about it. No, I don't want to.
I'm always open to your questions, Nasima.
Amazing. It was beautifully and eloquently said. So many relatable lines. The line about the baggage check. In an airport, the avocado toast, the millennial avocado toast. One of my favorite lines though was towards the end when you said about the children in cages and just before that you said, I bite my tongue till it bleeds, and you mentioned the children in cages and said, as if my tongue isn't still sore. Talk to me about that line.
It's just, I feel like the tongue is just such a great metaphor, not just because I've bitten my tongue so much as an immigrant and not saying the things that I really want to say, because, you know, obviously if you say them, you might get attacked, you know, people might get violent with you, but also it's our mother tongue, you know, it has to do with our language and We stress it out so much trying to recreate our parents' accents in our own mother tongues. I don't know. It's just such a... there's so much behind it. And I feel like I can't even really explain how much there is, but I feel like you get it.
Absolutely, absolutely get it. And, you know, that was a really beautiful and powerful poem. And every single poem so far that we've gone through and that I know that we're going to come to in this show is they're so relatable because we all share that being a third culture kid, our parents being immigrants or, you know, growing up here or maybe moving here and migrating here. And, you know, there was so much in there that I absolutely resonated with. So thank you so much for your work and thank you for performing for us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Okay, so this poet is actually pressure for me to introduce because not only is she one of my favourite people in the whole wide world, but she's one of my favourite poets. She's my boss, but really I'm her boss. We have a great working relationship and she's everything that YI does, the reason why we exist. She's a matriarch of YI and honestly, like, go buy her book! If you didn't hear that, I said go buy her book because it's incredible. And here's a poem from the most incredible, I can't even use my words, like she's one of the most amazing people, poets. Yeah, this is Miss Shirley May.
Hi everyone, this poem is called Miss Immigration. And nobody else introduced their poems, but because I'm the great Shirley May, I'm gonna introduce mine. And I wrote this after longing to go to Jamaica and being on the soil that was my mother's land, but coming up across Miss Immigration. I feel we're displaced. I feel it like I feel your body press up against me, reassuring me that only death will separate us now. Your sunshine kisses me. It kisses more than my skin, feeds me, burns deep, singeing me to this place, Jamaica, the Jamaican earth. What is your purpose on this occasion on my island? Who have you come to see? Visit with me, people. Relax a while. You know, ordinary. I smile. And she does not return the efforts at my light conversation. Mama used to say, bad manners reflected upon her. So be well-mannered and civil. It could earn you a paradise plum, a mint bar, or a beating. Only if Mama was truly upset did Jamaican swear words come out of her mouth. Yet she never quite abandoned her stateliness. Even then, the ad bomba clat, ras clat. No eye-to-eye contact from Miss Immigration with she bad mind self. No acknowledgement that this your sister had returned. Nothing but another question. What's in the bag? Nothing but my clothes. Everything in my heart, though. Still, I hear my mother's voice in my head. Harsh words stir up strife, while soft words turn away wrath. He that keepeth his mouth, keepeth his life. I reeled off a list of bad words. They had briefly invaded my mind. They all ended in clart. But I made no utterance. Without a warning, Miss Immigration threw me a curveball. Wide like the ocean we did just cross. She smiled. Enjoy yourself, she said, in Jamaica, and spend. I said, spend. I'm glad I'm here. You see, I know some of you, your angles look a little tired in places, and you could have smartened up because you knew I was coming. But I don't mind. Mama taught me to love you, and I love you. Thank you.
Amazing. Miss Shirley May, every time I hear you do a poem, it warms my heart. There's something so familial about when I think of poetry and when I think of you. And it was just warming and beautiful. And yeah, it just made me feel good. There's a really lovely cheekiness when you do your poetry. And also when you use patois, I feel like that really came across in that poem. And another thing that I really wanted to mention is the line where you said, harsh words stir up strife, in reference to something that your mother used to say. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, my mum used to, my mother was really quite what we call in Caribbean, speaky spoky, and which means that she was pretty posh. Anyway, she used to say, soft answers turn away wrath, but harsh answers stir up strife. I don't know whether or not I gave the line justice in trying to speak it in patois, but that's what the ultimately what it meant is that, you know, if you speak to somebody softly, they're going to speak to you softly. And in the back of my mind, when I was talking to this immigration woman, I could hear her speaking. So yeah, that's where the line comes from.
That was beautiful.
Thank you. I was also saying that, you know, I really kind of related to the poems of Ella and Lulu, who are also, you know, come from families that are diaspora families, people that have moved here, migrant families. And my experience in that poem was about me returning to Jamaica and expecting everybody to love me because my mother made me love that country. And so it was interesting to arrive and this woman was looking so miserable. And then she just turned this beam on me and I was like, okay, I'm home.
Definitely, that love definitely comes across. And another thing that comes across, the reason why I actually referred to that line, was just the things that the language and the customs and the traditions and things that we learn from our parents. Because recently, we've had a conversation about this recently, and
that's right.
Yeah, I feel like it reminded me of a time where you said to me that, you know, your mother lives on within you. And I feel like that book in itself is an ode to your mother. You know, she wrote her own eulogy. And again, I'm going to say, buy the book to everyone.
Oh, thank
because
you.
It really is. It's so special. It's such a special piece of work. And yeah, there's so much in there that when I've read it in recent weeks as well, that I just feel, you know, there's so many special moments that you've captured so beautifully. I mean, you've always said it's 10 years of work, you always say. And, you know, I can really feel that because you've got so many special moments in there. So thank you, Shirley.
Thank you very much. And thank you for all of you doing this particular project. I really, really appreciate both yourself and Ali being the producers on this, drawing us all together to talk about the way that our mother's language is our resistance. I mean, we used to use this language basically because, and especially patois, being first generation young people, we wanted to identify with our parents and almost make us a bit mysterious, you know, that the kids that we were going to school with couldn't understand us. So thank you for doing all this hard work. You've been marvellous, both of you. Well done.
Thank you. Well, it was my absolute pleasure, honestly. This evening has had so many inspiring. I said earlier that I've written down so many lines from people's poems because I've just been so inspired by everything that I've heard. So thank you.
No, thank you.
That was the most intense hour of poetry that I have been to in a very long time. Truly were words of resistance, words of inspiration, words of language and belonging, and words of reassurance for me as an artist, of just being able to express what I'm feeling in my own language. I didn't give you a poem because I didn't feel that I needed to fill this space anymore, because we have just heard from honestly, it's just been fire after fire after fire. And I was going to, but I'm not going to anymore because I feel like you've had enough. And next time you want to come and see our show, you should pay us. Ali, come through.
Well, there we have it. And I think Nasima's telling you to come back for the second show that we do to hear her poem. So we're going to have to do another show.
Yeah, we've already spoken about this, haven't we? We want to continue this project, and Young Identity was where it was with whom it started with. We're both Young Identity poets, and I mean, you will never see a more diverse group of artists with so much to say and so many truths to tell. And yeah, I know you'll be back. You can't get enough of us.
I think you know, when we came up with this idea, we recognize that people are in different places with their mother languages. And we've seen that. I think we've had poems where we've heard quite a lot of the language, like Jova's. We've heard poems which are about trying to actually grab that language, like Ella's. And we've had poems in between all of those ends as well. And I think our relationship to our mother tongues constantly is at the heart of that question of who are we in this place. And I think we all have a place in that, everyone who's performed today. So it's been wonderful. And thank you for everyone that's been that's performed. And thank you for everyone that's been watching this. I hope you enjoyed.
Absolutely. If you want to catch any more of our work, any more of our events, just search Young Identity in your Google search. We're online on Twitter at Young Identity MCR. On Instagram, we are Young ID MCR. Join us. Come on our journey. Hear some more words if you've not already. Thank you.
Thank you and goodbye.
Amazing.